We're in one of our favorite places, Southern California, to drive this, the Polestar 1, but it isn't a first drive. We drove this about a year ago. It's actually a farewell drive. The Polestar 1 is going away. Let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racing driver, lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get stories for drivers from drivers. Now, this Polestar 1 is a very unique car. If you're a fan of the channel, you know we drove it last year, and it's seriously impressive for a lot of reasons. But as I mentioned, this is sort of a farewell. This is the last internal combustion engine powered Polestar that we will ever see. Yes, they're going all electric going forward. Now, about this Polestar 1, I really don't want to see it go. Yes, it's at the end of the production run. As of this very moment, the last of the Polestar 1s have been produced. So if you can get your hands on one, there are still some new Polestar 1s around. So if you're looking at something like this, you might want to look right about now. Regardless, this Polestar 1 is so unique and it's so special for so many different reasons. And we could talk about design at length. I mean, this thing is a stunner. And as we experienced on that previous drive of the Polestar 1, we got stopped so often, it was like driving a bright pink Lamborghini. However, if you're unfamiliar with what's going on here, especially in terms of the driveline, let's look at the technical details in a little more depth. Mechanically and technologically, this is a very interesting car. For starters, everything above the floor is all carbon fiber, and at 500 units a year, this is pretty much handmade. This drivetrain is very complex, so try to keep up. There's the standard 2-liter turbo and supercharged 4-cylinder engine that you find in many modern Volvos, and it's on the big tune. 326 horsepower at 6,000 RPM and 384 pounds of torque at 2,600 to 4,200 RPM. But wait, there's more. In the rear, there are two electric motors, one that powers each rear wheel. They're each rated at 85 kilowatts, and together they produce another 232 horsepower and 354 pounds of torque. Combined, this drivetrain makes big numbers. A total, get this, of 619 horsepower and 738 pounds of torque. Supercar numbers for sure, and these are the kind of numbers that suit the svelte looks of the Polestar 1. The battery pack is a total of 34 kilowatt hours, and range is said to be about 78 miles. The transmission is an 8-speed automatic, which obviously drives the front wheels only. As I mentioned, the chassis is interesting. It's got a steel floor, carbon fiber bodywork from the floor on up, double pane glass, heated wipers. Fuel filling happens on the right, charging happens on the left, and there is an active spoiler on the rear deck lid. Suspension is based on AA arms at the front, a transverse composite leaf spring in the rear, Öhlins dual force valve dampers with an internal bleed valve that addresses those high velocity damper piston movements. Brakes are 6-piston Akebono calipers at the front with 400mm rotors, 4-piston calipers at the rear, 390mm rotors, and the rotors are 2-piece, and it's also brake by wire. Steering is electric and it does have variable assist. Wheels are 21x9 at the front, 10-inch wide at the rear. The tires are Pirelli P0s with 275s at the front and 295s at the rear. With all of the technology and certainly all the batteries on board, this does weigh a fair bit. It's just a few shy of 5,200 pounds. In terms of weight distribution, it's a couple of points favoring the rear axle, but on this channel, we know it's not static weight distribution that matters, it's how you use it. It's that time in the episode 4, how to spec your Polestar 1. Here's the thing, given that the last Polestar 1 has already come off the production line, all you're left with is what's in the market today.
Base price is $155,000 in the US or $197,000 in Canada. There are only 5 paint color choices, all appropriately subdued and understated. There is either a dark or light upholstery choice, and there are 3 wheel finishes you can choose from, along with your choice of chrome trim like this or a high gloss black. The only option is matte paint, which is $5,000 US or $7,500 Canadian.
So how do you spec yours? Well, that's all going to depend on what Polestar has in new inventory. From my perspective, sitting right here behind the steering wheel, this is just about perfection. I've got a great relationship to the car, and I'm supported by one of the best seats in the business. This is comfortable, it's supportive, it's everything I want for whatever I'm doing today. 200 hard miles in this Polestar 1 on some great roads in California. This is just perfection. And on top of that, great visibility. As you know, ergonomics are from Volvo. The interior design is very much lifted from Volvo, and that is not a bad thing. This is one of the most attractive interiors in the business. And of course, there are some nice touches like carbon fiber trim, and everything in here is just right. It's absolutely a driver's car. Given that this is really a grand touring coupe or a personal luxury coupe, those rear seats are pretty much useless. I've got a bag in the back right now, and that's about all the back seats are good for. They're definitely not helpful when you're taking passengers in a Polestar 1. You definitely don't want to sit back there, although I think I have been in a Polestar 1 where someone actually volunteered to sit in the back, and it was not a good idea. When it comes to performance and all of this drivetrain is working together in harmony, this thing will do 0 to 60 in a little over 4 seconds. That is just remarkable. It's electronically limited to about 155 miles an hour, I think, and it's pretty accessible given the amount of power and torque that this drivetrain makes, that's for sure. A good portion of my drive today has been in the wet. It's been raining. Now it's a little drier, but I have to talk about traction and the way that this drivetrain has been calibrated to put down power is simply astonishing. Exiting out of corners is just flawless. You'd think it would be difficult given that you've got an internal combustion engine and an 8-speed automatic up at the front and then the two electric motors at the rear, and there might be some clumsiness to the way it works, but that's absolutely not the case. In low grip conditions, this is amazing. And when you're hustling this thing, all putting down power, this thing just blows my mind. I didn't have those conditions when we were driving it last time, so it's been a real treat to drive it in some wet conditions. Keep in mind, however, that the drivetrain is not sports car sharp. It's not sports car precise. That's not a dual clutch gearbox. It is calibrated more aligned with this car's role as a luxury grand touring coupe. And it's got more of a relaxed character than anything else. But given the amount of power and the amount of torque that it makes, you're rarely caught in the wrong gear. What I've done now is change to the power, and that's all things working together in wonderful harmony, and this is just a blast to drive. Wow. You do get a little bit of that four-cylinder sound, but otherwise, this is just amazing. It's a delight to play with on these roads. Since we're on a wonderful section of road, let's talk about handling. These Öhlins dampers do such a wonderful job controlling body and wheel motion, soaking up bumps. Transitions are just superb. Whoever the engineers were that calibrated this suspension, they've done an excellent job with this thing. This is just remarkable. Given that this is a big plug-in hybrid luxury coupe, it's still a thrill to drive and throw around through some corners like this. Just a blast. Even the steering system is well calibrated. It's quick enough, although I'd like a slightly quicker steering rack here, but otherwise it's quick enough that it is responsive and controllable even near its limits. And earlier when I was driving in the wet, it was just a blast. It's never putting a foot wrong. It's so easy to pilot here. And then you've got all of that torque from this drivetrain. Wow. And even braking is excellent. Braking power is just astonishing given the weight of this Polestar 1. I don't recall the brake feel from my previous tester, but I'd like this to be a little sharper on initial application, especially for corners like this. But otherwise, braking power is quite good. And once you're into the brake pedal, modulation is excellent. What I find really outstanding is they've done a great job of blending the regenerative braking function with the actual mechanical braking function when I'm stepping on that brake pedal. There's not an odd feeling like you find in some hybrids. This is just exceptionally well calibrated. Love the brake pedal, except for that little bit of extra bite I'd like at the initial part of braking. But otherwise, love this brake pedal, love the braking power. So controllable. What I really want to talk about, however, is this wonderful blend of ride and handling that this Polestar 1 has. It's simply a wonderful balance between outright grip and comfortable ride. They've done a fine job with this. This is the kind of car that is not going to beat you up over long distances. And I'm doing nearly 200 miles today, and I feel just as rested now as I did when I got into the Polestar 1 this morning. Sure, I'm a bit saddened that this Polestar 1 is coming to an end. And yeah, the last cars have been produced. This is such a stunning piece, but it is so unique given the crazy drivetrain, the crazy complex drivetrain that this thing has, the specialized construction of this, and the fact that it's completely distinctive. You cannot buy a more attractive coupe than this. This is a stunner of a car. If you're wondering what's happening with Polestar now that this one is coming to an end, well, let me enlighten you. The two is going to continue, and I've driven the two a couple of times. It's a neat little electric. That is going to be their volume product, and it's very much a global product as well. In the next few months, the three is going to be here. Think of that like a Volvo XC90 size crossover, but it is a pure EV. Then the next product for them will be the Polestar 4, and that will be a slightly smaller EV crossover. Think of that like an XC60 sized crossover. Then following that, the Precept will come to life as the 5, and that'll be a low volume, high end sports coupe. And again, it's EV only. But what's really going on at Polestar is they're developing a lot of their own technology. They're developing their own motors for these things. So they're not buying off the shelf stuff from any of the typical EV suppliers. They're doing their own stuff, and they're coming up with their own battery architecture and electrical architecture. They're going to share some of that with Volvo and Geely products, of course, but they're doing a lot of their own work. And what they're going to do is position these vehicles as luxury performance EVs. And I'm very excited to see what they're going to do. On top of that, the Polestar 3 that's coming is going to be built in the United States. My verdict, well, I've said it before and I'll say it again, perhaps for the final time. This thing is stunning. It's so unique. It attracts a tremendous amount of attention, and it's a beautiful thing to drive. I just love this Polestar 1, and I'm very sad that it's going away. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look and saying farewell to this Polestar 1. Hope you liked this episode. And if you did, well, you're not new to YouTube. You know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring. So please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need to see car stories from drivers for drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. If you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves. Not even Polestar 1s with understeer mitigation technology. People drift on this road. I think that's what's going on here. That's what's going on. People use this road for drifting. Isn't that interesting? Wow, this is so much fun.